Hi, I'm Matt Binneker, the Director of Clinical Virology and Vice Chair of Practice in the Department of Laboratory Medicine and Pathology at Mayo Clinic. Based on recent studies, a considerable proportion of patients with encephalopathy and or epilepsy of unknown etiology may have an autoimmune or paraneoplastic disorder. Many of these cases remain unrecognized and don't receive appropriate treatment in the form of immunotherapies. In this month's hot topic, my colleague will discuss two validated predictive models based on clinical features and an initial neurologic assessment. I hope you enjoy this month's hot topic, and I want to personally thank you for allowing Mayo Clinic the opportunity to partner in your patient's healthcare.
Thank you for this opportunity to present and discuss our predictive model for neural-specific antibody seropositivity among patients with epilepsy and encephalopathy. These are my disclosures. Autoimmune encephalitis and autoimmune epilepsy were once considered extremely rare, but lately this perception has changed. A considerable proportion of these cases have neural-specific antibody biomarkers. As we see in this figure, these antibodies are either directed towards cell surface antigens or intracellular antigens. Some antibodies directed against the extracellular or cell surface antigens are considered pathogenic, whereas those against intracellular epitopes are biomarkers, and many of these diseases are considered T-cell mediated. New serological biomarkers are being discovered nearly every year. Currently, we have more than 20 neural-specific biomarkers of autoimmune encephalitis. This has contributed to increased recognition of autoimmune encephalitis cases. In a population-based study performed in Olmsted County, Minnesota, we found that the incidence of autoimmune encephalitis had nearly tripled over the last two decades, increasing from 0.4 per 100,000 to 1.2 per 100,000. This was mostly due to increased recognition of antibody-positive cases. Furthermore, we found that the incidence and prevalence of autoimmune encephalitis was similar to infectious encephalitis with known pathogens. We have noticed similar trends among patients with epilepsy of a known etiology. Nearly 15 to 20% of patients with cryptogenic epilepsy with or without other features of encephalitis have serological biomarkers suggestive of an autoimmune etiology. In a prospective study, over a period of 1 year, we found about 23 of 112 cases with epilepsy of a known etiology were seropositive for neural autoantibodies. The specificity of these antibodies varied considerably in patients with new-onset epilepsy compared to those with established or chronic epilepsy. New-onset epilepsy cases had a higher proportion of more specific serological biomarkers, such as NMDA receptor antibodies or LGI1 antibodies, which are likely to be pathogenic. Interestingly, patients found to be seropositive and subsequently treated with immunotherapy had a considerably better outcome compared to patients who continued to have epilepsy of unknown etiology and were treated symptomatically with anti-seizure medications. During this study, we also analyzed various factors associated with autoantibody seropositivity. We applied the predictive model, APE score, to every patient who was enrolled into the study. This is a composite model based on various predictors analyzed in our prior retrospective studies. We subsequently evaluated this model among epilepsy patients at Mayo Clinic. We collected data from patients on whom autoantibody evaluations were sent from all three Mayo Clinic sites. This included 387 patients with a diagnosis of epilepsy. On analysis, we found factors which were predictors of seropositivity. Majority of these factors were already a part of APE score. We subsequently evaluated usefulness of this predictive model for autoimmune encephalopathy or dementia as well. In the process, we included some revisions in the original scoring system, leading to formulation and validation of APE2 score, which could be applied to both patients with epilepsy as well as patients with cognitive dysfunction. The variables in APE2 score are based on clinical evaluation, such as new onset epilepsy, neuropsychiatric manifestations, autonomic dysfunction, initial MRI and CSF findings. MRI and CSF evaluations are usually a part of diagnostic evaluations of epilepsy or encephalopathy of unknown etiology patients. Therefore, this score could be utilized by most clinicians, even in primary care setting or emergency departments, where most esoteric evaluations are not available. These are some examples of medial temporal or flare T2 hyperintensities, which are included as a part of the APE2 score. The first one is an example of a patient with LGI1 antibody, the second one with MAR2 encephalitis, and the third, a patient with ANA1 or anti-HU antibodies. This is an example of a patient with multifocal MRI brain lesions, which has also been included in APE2 scoring system. This is associated with GABA A receptor antibodies. Similar MRI features can also be found in patients with MOG antibodies, some of which can present with epilepsy or encephalopathy. APE2 score of more than equal to 4 performed well as a predictor of neural autoantibody positivity. The sensitivity of neural-specific autoantibody positivity among patients with epilepsy or encephalopathy for APE2 score more than equal to 4 was 98%. Whereas the specificity was approximately 84%. Higher APE2 scores, such as one more than 6, had even higher specificity for an autoimmune etiology. This flowchart demonstrates application of APE2 score among patients with cognitive dysfunction. It shows how APE2 score was able to identify patients consistent with the diagnosis of neural-specific antibody-positive autoimmune encephalitis. It also shows how most patients without underlying autoimmunity but seropositive for antibodies with lower specificity for autoimmune encephalitis or dementia scored lower on the predictive model. Using our data, we also utilized APE2 score among patients with epilepsy of unknown etiology to propose a diagnostic criteria for autoimmune epilepsy via this flow diagram. Now we will discuss application of APE2 score using some patient examples. A 58-year-old woman presented to an outside hospital with electric shock-like sensations on the right side of the body and speech arrest lasting for 30 to 60 seconds, along with few episodes of secondary generalized tonic-clonic seizures. On initial workup, no clear etiology was found. She was treated with multiple anti-seizure medications but continued to have refractory seizures. 3 years later, she presented to Mayo Clinic with oral-lingual dyskinesias and stridor. Her MRI demonstrated bilateral medial temporal flared hyperintensities. Her CSF analysis demonstrated elevated CSF protein. So if you calculated this patient's APE2 score, it comes out to be 8. She gets 2 points for facial dyskinesias, 2 points for refractory seizures, 2 points for inflammatory CSF, and 2 for medial temporal flared hyperintensities. An autoimmune epilepsy panel was sent, which came back to be positive for ANA2 or anti-RE antibody. This particular antibody is typically associated with brainstem encephalitis but can present with involvement of the limbic system, as was the case in this patient. Among these cases, it is very important to screen for lung or breast cancer. This is another example of a 60-year-old gentleman who had long history of smoking. He was transferred to our hospital with 3-week history of new onset refractory seizures. He was also having significant behavioral problems and short-term memory loss. His MRI brain was found to be normal. However, his CSF showed 10 white blood cells. CSF evaluation for infectious etiologies was unremarkable. If we calculate APE2 score for this patient, he gets 1 point for new onset seizures, 1 point for neuropsychiatric changes, 2 points for refractory epilepsy, and 2 points for inflammatory CSF. His total score comes out to be 6. In this case, autoimmune encephalopathy panel ordered in both CSF and serum, came back to be positive for GABA B receptor antibodies. This particular antibody is associated with cognitive dysfunction, refractory epilepsy, as we were seeing in this case, and in about 50 to 60% of cases, patients have small cell lung cancer. In the third example, a 72-year-old man with progressive memory loss over 6 years was evaluated in neurology clinic. His MRI brain showed global atrophy, but his CSF showed mildly elevated protein at 65 milligrams per DL. He only gets 2 points for elevated CSF protein on APE2 score. However, his clinician sent an autoimmune dementia panel, which later came back to be negative. This highlights one of the main benefits of using APE2 score would be optimal utilization of resources and, in some cases, avoidance of unnecessary testing. In the fourth example, we apply APE2 score to a previously reported case. A 71-year-old woman presented with 6-week history of frequent involuntary jerking movements involving her right face and arm, as shown in this video. Her MRI brain showed bilateral medial temporal flare hyperintensities. If we calculate APE2 score for this patient, she gets 1 point for new onset seizures, 2 points for medial temporal changes on the MRI, and 3 points for facio-brachial dystonic seizures, leading to a total score of 6. Her diagnostic workup was found to be remarkable for LGI1 antibodies. Facio-brachial dystonic seizures are pathognomic for LGI1 autoimmunity. Some of these cases can have normal brain MRI and CSF analysis. However, still most of these cases would score 4 or more based on the differential weighting of the APE2 score. To conclude, APE2 score is a useful predictive model based on clinical criteria, which can aid in diagnosis and management of autoimmune epilepsy and encephalopathy. Very low APE2 scores may be useful in identifying patients which are more likely to have a negative neural-specific autoantibody evaluation. Furthermore, in some cases with epilepsy of unknown etiology, after reasonable exclusion of alternative etiologies, this model can also help in early diagnosis and early immunotherapy initiation.